Have you ever heard that they made movies in Ithaca?
Yes, I have.
What, do you know of any of the movies that they supposedly made here?
No, I don't. I think they were back when they were making silent films. Way before my time.
Nice. Okay.
Yeah, there was silent movies, and I also heard because the film had a nitrogen base, they dumped a lot of the films into the Lake Cayuga. That's all, and I'm not really sure exactly. I heard that Little Rascals was filmed here.
They shot The Sure Thing at Cornell, didn't they? Parts of it, something, I've heard that.
And then the old silent movies, a couple Tarzan movies or something.
Mm-hmm. I heard that! Johnny Weissmuller, someone was telling me that last night.
The Little Rascals they did on Buffalo Street right here, though. That's it.
Going down the hill.
Yeah.
Right, that's what a lot of people think. The Little Rascals was all done in Los Angeles.
Really?
But people think we have a hill.
Uh-huh. Buffalo
like
Street.
That. Right.
I know exactly what he's talking
about. Yeah, Buffalo Street Hill, I was just saying.
We know the Little Rascals were filmed here on Buffalo Street.
I know. Right over here.
Right, right. Definitely. You watched it, right? You were
there. Well, we didn't.
I used to watch Little Rascals every
no,
day.
No, I watched it on TV. We
of
didn't
course
watch
you watched it on TV. Where else you going to watch it?
Most of the Little Rascals didn't look like they were done in Ithaca, though, did they?
No, it didn't. It didn't look like someone totally different.
Okay. Action. Very good. Sprout. Look at the camera. You remember the bag. Go get the bag.
In the making of a film, there's a great deal that takes place that the viewing public never gets a chance to see. There are a number of people who work behind the scenes, each performing their individual task, who are only recognized by a small and fleeting final credit. Such was the case in the making of They Made Movies in Ithaca. This film was the final result of a four-week summer film institute at Ithaca College, which was designed to give beginning and advanced students the opportunity and experience of working on a full-length documentary alongside working professionals. It was out of their combined learning and working experience that a film was created. Narrator for the film was the late Emmy Award-winning writer and producer Rod Serling, who had been a visiting professor at Ithaca College and an invaluable asset to the development and growth of their School of Communications for many years.
Without trying to be corny about it, Elliot, I'm delighted they're making film. It's been my concern on a college level that we don't shoot enough footage, that we take too much out of a textbook, that we listen much too much to lectures, that we hear how, but we never are shown what. And to me, that text, from a text point of view, from an educative point of view, I think is the only way to learn how to shoot movies. And the other thing being this level of be brave about it. If it's never been done, try it. If it looks like an inordinate shot, shoot it. If you've never seen it before, by all means, try it. The horizons of this thing are limitless, the way to make movies. And within the realm of every single individual who's shooting the picture is a strange capacity to do something different, which they should do.
This film, made by the Biograph Company in the early 1900s, is entitled Animated Picture Studio and shows the basics of filmmaking in its early years. Here we see a simple filming of a performance, the developing of the film in the darkroom, and the projection of the finished product. moving picture is one art form that is essentially American. It is popular and indigenous to the United States, if one were to trace the early development of the film medium. At the turn of the century, Cornell physics professor G.S. Moeller borrowed a human skeleton from the anatomy department at Cornell and proceeded to make possibly the first movie using frame-by-frame photography. This animated motion picture made here in Ithaca was called Skeleton Dance. Shortly after Professor Moeller's Skeleton Dance, a camera crew from Thomas Edison Studios out of West Orange, New Jersey, arrived here in Ithaca to film scenes of the 1901 Cornell-Columbia Penn crew race. This film also shows the Lehigh Valley observation train crossing the entrance to Renwick Park and running along the southeast shore of Cayuga Lake. This is the earliest existing motion picture filmed here in Ithaca. In 1903, this French film, entitled The Magic Lantern, demonstrates the motion in motion pictures, still in its infancy, using magic as well as dancing as a means of performance and storyline. Some of the techniques were still experimental at this point. In 1907, filmmaking was becoming more of an accepted art form. Camera and lighting techniques were improving along with the story's content and the actor's skills. At this point, many new studios were appearing. Thomas Edison was to appoint Theodore Wharton as the first director of photography for the Calum Film Company of New Jersey. Within the next 5 years, Theodore Wharton began working for the Chicago-based S&A Film Company. In 1912, the S&A Film Company sent Wharton to Cornell University to film a Cornell football game. While here in Ithaca, Wharton was so impressed with the local scenery, he vowed to return to Ithaca to continue shooting films for S&A. He was given that chance 1 year later, returning that summer, 1913, with his own crew and actors and the S&A Film Company blessings. During the summer months, many one- and two-reel films were produced by S&A's Special Eastern Company. In September 1913, Ted Wharton left Ithaca and the S&A Film Company, heading to the Badlands of South Dakota to direct factual recreations of four major Indian battles, with the technical assistance of Buffalo Bill Cody and the U.S. Cavalry at the government's request. Upon completion of this project, Wharton returned to Ithaca with his brother Leopold to establish his own film studios.
They came to Ithaca, star and filmmaker alike, because of the natural beauty of the locale. Nowhere else could they find the variety of terrains that figured so largely in their exterior-oriented productions. They had the gorges by Cornell, the falls of Taganic, and the lakefronts of Beebe and Cayuga. Thank you. They went for the natural location and the realism that they provided.
Ithaca wasn't the only small town hoping to benefit from the growing film production industry. In April of 1914, the Warden Brothers Incorporated, thus establishing a permanent studio effective May 1st of that year. The Whartons agreed to label all the films produced here as Made in Ithaca, New York, putting Ithaca on the map. The Whartons produced several feature films during the 1914 season. Also by this time, Ithaca-made films were being shown at local theaters to overflow crowds. Many Ithacans were now participating in the Whartons' films as extras. Distribution of the Whartons' films was controlled by a French company, Pathé Frères. With war just breaking out in Europe, it was feared that this would halt film production here in Ithaca. However, just the opposite was the case. European studios were shut down, and the demand for feature films increased the Whartons' production. We are now approaching the Stewart Avenue Bridge, built in 1899 to improve the trolley line that served Cornell Heights. A silent film made by the Wharton Studios immortalized the bridge in a scene in which a runaway trolley plunged 200 feet into the gorge below, the hero jumping to safety just in the nick of time.
Do you know anything about that?
Not really, except one picture, which my husband, Alan, took way back. His brother knew when they were going to start this film, the sequence of a film. So he told him to be over there at 7 o'clock in the morning with his little Brownie camera, which he was, and he took this picture, which I think has been shown many times.
This is supposedly from a film made by Whartons called The Kiss of Blood. This is the car number 305, which they actually put derailleurs on the bridge and false railings and photographed it from three or four different views. And the bad guy is, of course, supposed to go over in the car, and the good guy jumps off at the last minute, one of those cliffhanger types. And you can see that there was probably about 2,000 people that viewed this spectacle, and you can see them up here on other trolleys and on top. And there's a film crew right here with a camera rolling. This is the results of number 305 going over the bridge for the movie. As you can see, quite flattened car. And this is the one they threw over the gorge, and he's going to zoom up on the set of wheels, which I have in my front yard now.
In August of 1914, the Pathé players arrived in Ithaca to enact scenes in The Perils of Pauline. They were allowed the use of Wharton Studios. The Perils of Pauline introduced the world to the cliffhanger technique of filmmaking, leaving the audience hanging until the next episode appeared in the theaters. At the same time, newspapers excited readers with colorful stories that turned the delightful and daring heroine of the series into a larger-than-life matinee idol. This technique proved to be very successful, and it catapulted Pearl White into movie stardom. And now, a few scenes from the serial that started it all, The Perils of Pauline.
Thank you. Thank you.
In early 1915, the Whartons were contracted by Pathé to produce the follow-up serial of The Perils of Pauline entitled The Exploits of Elaine. Originally set for 10 episodes, was extended to 14 and finally to 20 episodes. Like The Perils, most of the exploits were filmed in New Jersey and New York, but unlike The Perils, The Exploits of Elaine were actually produced by the Wharton brothers. Now, here are a few segments of The Exploits of Elaine.
Thank you.
Following the phenomenal success of the exploits, the Wharton brothers returned to Ithaca and leased the Renwick Amusement Park and set up their studios at the south end of Cayuga Lake. They had signed a 5-year lease agreement with the option to purchase. The Whartons then began production with a follow-up serial to The Exploits of Elaine entitled The Romance of Elaine, which was itself to be 9 episodes in length. This film followed the storyline established in the preceding Pearl White serials, thus confusing many Ithacans who witness this Perils of Pauline-like production being filmed in Ithaca.
The old open-air roller skating rink was enlarged and became the soundstage and base of their operations.
Yeah, it was a big barn-like thing, the stage up in the back. Very dark in there. And the back area was lighted with lights all around it. All the sets was lighted. And they had scenery men and electricians there all the time working on changing things from one set to the next. But the rest of it was just a large barn-like building with a little room off to the side that was cutting room.
They converted some buildings and erected others to suit the needs of production. A cutting room was added to the soundstage. Quarters were created for the 1,001 props, set pieces, and costumes of the company. The tower served as the administrative office. Shirley Bass was the secretary.
The office, not too small, it had a typewriter, Mr. Buck had a desk and an office in one corner, and Theodore had another table, and Leopold had another. They all had, you know, a place in the office. And then on the walls, they had pictures of stars who were known then.
The Whartons, upon completion of the Elaine series, began work on yet another serial, this a comedy entitled The New Adventures of Rufus J. Wallingford. This 14-episode serial was contracted with Pathé. Here now is a segment of episode number 7 from a Wallingford series obtained from the Library of Congress film collection. This is entitled The Bang Sun Engine. Thank you. 1916, the Whartons began production of more serials, these for the International Film Service of New York City, owned by William Randolph Hearst. The first being The Mysteries of Myra, which began shooting in the spring. The Mysteries of Myra dealt with psychic phenomena and the afterlife. This was the first time special effects and double exposure work was needed in a film by the Whartons. Technical consultant for this series was magician Harry Houdini, whom at this time was becoming famous for exposing fake mediums. After completing the 14 episodes of the Myra serial, the Whartons began production of the Beatrice Fairfax series, also for the International Film Company. Now some scenes from this serial, based on a real-life newspaper advice column from 1916.
Thank you.
1916 proved to be a very busy year for the Wharton's Film Company. Upon completion of the 15th episode of the Beatrice Fairfax series, production had already begun on the feature film entitled The Lottery Man. This melodramatic film chronicles the adventures of a star football quarterback who is raffled off in a big lottery drawing. The winner gets a choice of $50,000 cash or the perfect husband, the quarterback himself. At this point in 1916, the Whartons were using multiple cameras, so several scenes could be enacted at one time. This was a fortunate position for the Whartons to be in because the new patriotic wartime serial Patria was now in progress. The Whartons' Renwick Park studios were now fully occupied by many well-known movie stars, including the famous dancer Irene Castle, who had the leading role in the Patria episodes.
Today we're performing Patria, which was the theme song from a movie produced in Ithaca in 1917, starring Irene Castle. And Marion McCurdy is here to sing that today. Irene Castle is also the composer of the song. She was a woman of many talents, dancer, actress, and composer.
Searching for somewhere, build a castle in the air. get your gun, get your gun. Johnny, show the Hun you're a son of the gun. Hoist the flag and let her fly. Yankee doodle, do or die. Pack your little kit, show your grip, do your bit. Yankees to the ranks from the towns and the tanks. Make your mother proud of you and the old red, white, and blue. Over there, over there. Send the word over there. That the Sammies are coming, the Sammies are coming. The sun, sun coming everywhere. So prepare, say a prayer. Send the word to beware. We'll be over, we're coming over. And we won't come back till it's over, over there.
Several other two-reel films were made during the remainder of 1918. These short films were now being produced and directed by Ithacan Robert Townley, who by now was well established within the Wharton Company. Due to the inflated cost of the picture production and the general decline in the movie attendance during the influenza epidemic, debts had continued to accumulate against the Whartons, culminating in the foreclosure of the Wharton Studio. The property sold from the Wharton Studios consisted of scenery, furniture, lighting equipment, and other general motion picture producing paraphernalia. The films were removed from the film vaults located in Renwick Park and placed in a film storage magazine by attorney Howard Cobb, who was in charge of the foreclosure, in hopes of selling them in the future. Not all the films made in Ithaca were dumped in Cayuga Lake, like some people believed. The films removed from the vaults were stored behind attorney Howard Cobb's home at the intersection of Burdick Hill Road and East Shore Drive. On May 3, 1919, Mrs. Irene Castle, widow of Vernon Castle, the dancer and aviator who was killed while flying in Texas on February 14th of 1918, was publicly married to Captain Robert E. Treeman of Ithaca. The father of the bridegroom, Robert H. Treeman, presented his new daughter-in-law with a splendid house and grounds situated on Cayuga Heights Road, now the Sigma Chi fraternity. The house boasted one of only a few built-in swimming pools in New York State outside of New York City. The newlyweds, as seen here, posed in many pictures alongside the pool and on the diving boards for movie magazines. Together, they formed their own moving picture company and produced several feature films which were financially unsuccessful. The war in France had ended, thus making the Eagle's Eye a great financial disaster because Americans wanted to forget the war and its negative impact on their lives. The Renwick Studios were now being leased by the Grossman Picture Company for the production of 20 episodes of the Million Dollar Reward serial. Leopold Wharton, along with nearly half the Wharton studio, crew, and actors, left Ithaca to start film production in the Wharton's boyhood home of San Antonio, Texas. Theodore Wharton remained in Ithaca, setting up a new studio next to the Globe Hotel on West State Street. He was contracted to produce three more serials for the Pathé Company and expected to stay here in Ithaca. But upon completion of these serials, the Pathé Company refused to accept or distribute the pictures. At the same time, Pathé also canceled contracts made with the Grossman Picture Company. As a result of these cancellations, work at both studios came to a standstill in November of 1919. Both companies stated that this was not the end of filmmaking in Ithaca. One last film was made during 1920. It was entitled If Women Only Knew and was produced by yet another film company, Cayuga Pictures. The following is a scene from that film. April of 1920, Ted Wharton had arrived in Los Angeles looking for studio accommodations to produce a spectacular feature film based on the Boxer Rebellion in China. Leo Wharton, meanwhile, continued producing silent films in San Antonio, Texas until 1926. Both brothers never were to return to Ithaca. In July of 1923, Irene Castle Treeman divorced Robert Lee Treeman in Paris, France, and went back to dancing in New York City. The films, stored behind Howard Cobb's home, now the Greystone Inn, burst into flames one afternoon during the summer of 1929. This event was witnessed by two of Howard Cobb's children, Virginia and Jack Cobb, who exclaimed, at the time, "There goes all those Ithaca films." None of the films survived the blaze. In that same year, Leopold Wharton died in San Antonio, Texas. His brother, Theodore Wharton, died of a thyroid ailment on November 28, 1931. Thus, the final chapter in Ithaca's silent filmmaking days was completed. If you look at a list of the actors and actresses that starred in Ithaca Bait movies, the names would read like the who's who of silent films. From the biggest name stars to the extras who are all but forgotten now, all of them were part of the glamour and charm of movie making that few cities the size of Ithaca ever experienced. The silver screen no longer flickered the scenes of those bygone days when the movies were really made in Ithaca. Walking down the streets of Ithaca and someone asks you what movies were made in Ithaca, you could say, well, let's see. There was The Hermit of Lonely Gulch, The Boundary Rider, A Prince of India, The Fireman and the Girl, The Romance of Elaine, The Adventures of Rufus J. Wallingford, Hazel Kirk, Mysteries of Myra, Beatrice Fairfax, The Black Stork, Patria, The Crusher, The Great White Trail, The Eagle's Eye, The Invisible Bond, The Crooked Dagger, A $1 Million Reward, and If Women Only Knew.